Praise the Lord. All right, we'll let our praise and worship team get settled. Praise God. All right. Yeah, right. And you know, I want to share something with you. You know, we have been talking lately about the grace of God and how it still goes hand in hand with the truth of God. I was at a meeting not too long ago with a bunch of pastors in the area from not only from Lehigh, but from Lehigh, Cape Coral, and Fort Myers. And in this meeting, originally it was just supposed to be for a Lehigh, and I have a vision for Lehigh. You know, anybody else, we believe in Lehigh, right? But then, you know, as it happens to other pastors there, Rich, I'm reminded, but it's not Lehigh alone, it's Fort Myers. And then also there was some Cape Coral pastors too, and I said, well, let's broaden the vision then. Why just Lehigh? And then the three came together, and I was reminded of the passage, you know, two were better than one. Right? Because if you fall down, you got someone to pick you up. If you're cold, someone's going to keep you warm. But it says a tricone forward. That's not easily broken, you know? And there's strength in that. So I see Lehigh, Fort Myers, and Cape Coral, God doing something wonderful in our region. This is what I feel. I know you feel it too. But let's look beyond Lehigh. And even with that, you know, when we come together, you know, I think of my brother and whoever else might come from Fort Myers or Cape Coral. You know, this is you know, a bigger than Lehigh thing. Well, one of the questions that was asked from one of the pastors was this. And the question was a similar question to what a lot of you ask and that you really hear in circles today, is what about this grace message? Because we have this grace message that seems to be very popular, all about the love of God, but we also want to know, where's the accountability with the grace message? And this one pastor says, you know, what about these grace churches that are popping up everywhere, and it seems like they throw everything else to the wind? You know, does anybody ever get involved in these conversations? By a show of hands, somebody please come. Okay, thanks. You three come over here. And we want to know what's the balance, you know, and we talked Tuesday about this. It's all throughout Scripture. Truth of the matter is this, if you preach grace the right way, if you preach it the right way, you're going to be judged for preaching too much grace. Because Paul did. When Paul preached grace, they said to him, does that mean we keep on sinning? Right? So this issue is not a new issue. It's an old issue. You know, and I think in regard to grace, first of all, or sometimes, we have to know what grace is not. And we also have to know what grace is. What it is and what it is not. If you have your Bibles, I want to start from a certain place. Because the title of today's teaching is Fallen from Grace. So if you have a Bible, why don't you turn to the book of Galatians, chapter 5. Let's read the first four verses. It says this, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. We all say it? Hallelujah. Stand firm then. And do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Okay, we're talking about grace and law here. Mark my words. I, Paul, tell you that if you let yourself be circumcised, this is really just a picture of being put back under the law again, Christ will be of no value to you. You can't serve the law and grace, is what it's saying here. And I declare to every man who lets himself be circumcised, this is verse 3, that he will be obligated to obey the whole law. Verse 4. You who are trying to be justified by the law have been alienated from Christ, and you have, the title of the lesson, fallen from grace. And many times, when you think of that term, fallen from grace, you might think of somebody who has fallen into great sin, and we all have labels for what that great sin might be. Fallen from grace. The truth is, fallen from grace is not being involved in necessarily the dirty sins of our lives, but it's being fallen from the place that gives us forgiveness from the dirty sins in our lives. Fallen from grace means you no longer have accessibility to acceptance and love and truth and peace again. So I wanted to share two illustrations with you, one from ancient history and one from our modern times. When you study the ages of time, one of my favorite courses in school were humanities. And humanities was you would study civilization from the beginning of time up until modern day. Anybody in high school, college, study humanities? And when I went to high school, they called it social studies. Anybody ever have social studies? They, oh yeah, they just renamed it and confused us all. But humanities is social studies. For some reason, and you know how you all have your favorite topic. Does everybody have a favorite topic? Who here likes math? Raise your hand. All right. Who here likes science? Raise your hand. Who here likes literature, reading and writing? Who here hates writing? Oh, yeah, I'm not the only one. Oh, my. I hate writing. I definitely hate it. All right, forgive me, boy. You too. And, you know, in social studies, I loved humanities. And, you know, some say civilization began at summer. You ever hear that phrase? Civilization, I know you have, Debbie. Civilization began at summer. Summer was a city in Mesopotamia. They believe civilization began there with the cuneiforms. You know, where they would do the printing in the clay? Others believe that civilization began in Egypt because, you know, the first writings in Egypt were the hieroglyphics. But as you study the ages of time, one of the ages that fascinated me the most, or one of the periods of time that fascinated me the most, was the Renaissance period. And the Renaissance period ran from about the 14th century to the 17th century. I'm sorry, am I boring you? Did you come to school today? What on earth? Are we in social studies today? And there'll be a quiz later. Now, the Renaissance period, I really love, and we get some of our greatest artists from that era. Does anybody know some of the artists from that period of time? Shout them out.
Michelangelo,
number one. Da Vinci. Anyone else? Those are the two primary ones. There were four well-known, and Da Vinci is one, Michelangelo is another. You have heard of Raphael, of course, and most of you who have watched Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles know Donatello. Because the four Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles were named after the four Renaissance men. I love that. And you see, in school we learned, and I'm gonna try to bring some old thinking back. In school we learned that Renaissance, I believe in French it means rebirth, and in Italian it means to be reborn. And what happened in the Renaissance period was this. They took all of the classical art, all of the classical literature and architecture, and they added to it a modern day understanding, and then it was widespread because now we had new technologies to let literature be printed and word of mouth got around. So the new things that they were able to do spread across Europe more quickly because of the new innovations we had. But the Renaissance era, it took the classics and brought them into modern time. And the classics were based in this. You guys okay so far? The classics were based in stuff like balance. Like the ancient Greeks, they always wanted balance, the perfect form. And other things were like a linear perspective where they would do their artwork and make sure everything was to scale, you know? And like even the Egyptians of old, when they built the pyramids, you know, they had all this math and science involved and everything in their arts and their literature, in their education, in their government, in their science. So a rebirth was this. They took the classics and then they put modern terms to it. And they transcended the classics. So if you've all heard of Michelangelo, what Michelangelo did was this. He took all of the classics, and the classics involved balance, measurement, form, structure, and he added to it his understanding of it. So he took that and he transcended that. And when he drew something, it seemed as if he didn't use structure. It seemed as if he didn't use balance. It seemed as if he didn't measure things, but you know he did. But he transcended it all. He took the law and he added something to it and made it sensational. He didn't throw away the basics, but he transcended them all. And in all of his, and you know the amazing thing about the Renaissance man, I'm amazed by these guys. Not only were they artists, they were sculptors, some of them scientists, some of them writers. These guys were absolutely amazing. I think of one thing that they did, like sculpturing. They would take a piece of marble, and you all know the statue of David, right? And then he'd go and do the ceiling in what church? The Sistine Chapel. These guys were amazing. I believe God put them on earth. I believe that period of time is a big picture of what God has done. He has taken the old and added the new. He took the law and added grace and created something phenomenal. And I see grace and law as that. As we come into this grace that's really on top of grace, we don't throw away the classics, right? You never throw away the classics. Moby Dick, Tale of Two Cities. Don't throw the classics away. But you can take them and bring them into modern day terms, right? And that's what they did, and that's why they're so big. But I want us to see that. I want us to see that as we're trying to understand or reconcile both law and grace, both truth and love. Because that's what it is. You guys with me? The law is absolutely the truth of God. But it must be mixed with love, otherwise it doesn't work and it hurts people. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You must mix the truth with the love of God to get something out of this world. And you can't have one without the other. You cannot have love without truth, because it doesn't have structure and safety. And I'm going to give you another example in a second where it gives you a good understanding. And you can't have the other either. You can't have truth without love. Because then we hurt people and we build robots and no one expresses themselves in a proper way, like Michelangelo and Da Vinci and Donatello and Raphael. You see, everybody in this room wants to be a Michelangelo. Everybody does. But how do you get there? You can't throw away the old. You have to add to it and transcend and go beyond it. And no, that's the basis of everything, but I can draw something so much greater than just inside these lines. And that is a picture of what law and grace is, what truth and love is. You transcend it all. That's what I see. And I'm going to give you a modern-day picture now. A modern-day picture. We were on the bus going up to SeaWorld, and we saw parental guidance. We saw it on our bus. Did you guys see that on your bus? Okay, because it was a repeat, right? But it was good, Brother Keith. That movie was perfect. Did anybody see parental guidance during our movie night? Has anyone seen parental guidance at all? Raise your hand. Okay. All right, those of you who didn't. In the book Parental Guidance, the grandparents were going to see the children and the grandchildren. And what the grandparents discovered was the children had a new way of raising, their children had a new way of raising the grandchildren. And the grandparents couldn't reconcile it all. It was foreign to them because it wasn't the classics. And they would go to them and they would say, well, what about the classics, man? And one example is this. They were coloring a picture in a restaurant. And the one child was coloring all out of the lines, just scribbling, scribbling, scribbling. And the grandfather said, what are you doing? He says, you got to paint inside the lines. And the parents said, no, we want them to express themselves. Have you guys seen that? So at the end of it all, you take the picture of what the child did who didn't paint inside the lines but expressed themselves, and looked like a mess. That's not Michelangelo. That you throw in the garbage on the way out of the restaurant. And maybe you kept the kids quiet for them. You know, maybe, but most of the time you didn't. That is love without truth. That is grace without the basics. And you can take that same picture and you can tell your children all the time, you got to stay inside the lines, you got to stay inside the lines, you got to stay inside the lines. But there still needs to be an avenue of expression. So I say the true painting and the true masterpiece that God is creating in your life and my life, it's not a picture where a child scribbled all out of the lines. That's not a masterpiece. That's a mess. I know you call it love, but it's a mess. Okay, and I don't want that mess either there or anywhere. Nobody wants that mess. You don't want that mess in your home, and don't tell me you do. Because you just want to get rid of it. Because you didn't teach him. Right? And that's all ages, that's adults too. You guys got beat up by kids, I got beat up by kids and adults. So the artist, the true masterpiece is not the scribble page. But the true masterpiece is also not the one that was all the way in the lines. That's not the masterpiece. That's still a child's work. You can take a crayon, you ever draw inside the lines and sometimes you take a black crayon to outline it? It's beautiful. But it's still child's. Both of them are child's work. The masterpiece is when I give you a blank piece of paper and you draw the mountains and the oceans and the sun and the rivers. You didn't draw inside the lines, you had the lines. It was like a part of your basic nature. You didn't draw by numbers. And I can give you an outline of something to color in, or I can say, could you paint me a scene of a forest or an ocean or a sunset? And then from your heart and from your vision of what you feel and believe, you paint a masterpiece. That is grace. That is grace that came from the classics of the law. Because the law was never bad. You said it was, it isn't. This can't have it alone. It has to have a transcendence. You have to live love with truth. We take love and throw truth away. Or we take truth and throw love away. But God wants to take him to marry and say, have you seen this masterpiece? Amazing. And God knows when he can give us a blank piece of paper and when he can't. And when we can't have a blank piece of paper, God tells you this. Michael, I want you to put a little bit of brown over here. Okay. He's a clown. I want you to put red in this circle here. You can put a little white. Well, give him some options. I think we'll put red, white, or blue over here. Until you give him a blank piece of paper and say, can you draw me a sunset? Can you draw me this? Amen.
Amen.
This is the heart of the Father that loves you and wants to teach you. Because grace, this is what we said in my meeting. We said, what about this grace? Grace does cover, but don't lose the second part of it. Love covers. But let me tell you what love also does. Love teaches.
Amen.
Amen. This is the grace of God, and this is the love of God. Where you can have the joy of putting a blank piece of paper in your child's hands or a blank piece of paper in anyone's hands. You know the metaphor we use. And say, just paint me a masterpiece. Isn't that beautiful? It's a marriage of the old and the new. The classics and then the heart of all. Love and truth. Grace and more. Praise God. You know, I'm going to give you just a couple of examples and close, although we could close right there, I believe. We can close right there, but I'm going to give you another picture. Do you remember when Moses received the Ten Commandments? We've seen the movies and we haven't read the book. Sometimes I prefer the movies, that's just the way it is, okay? Well, the book for accuracy. And Moses went up on the mountain, and God gave him the Ten Commandments. You know he gave them to him twice, right? Yeah, he broke the first one. The first Ten Commandments that were in the hands of Moses, he broke them. See, the law of Moses, or the law of the Old Covenant, can never be put in the hands of man. Because you can't follow them, you can't keep them, you can't apply them. You can't apply them to you, you can't apply them to your neighbor. I know that. They're broken all the time. Doesn't mean you throw them away, though. Doesn't mean you throw them away. Doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Doesn't say paint outside the lines. God says this. This time, he went back on the mountain the second time and gave the second pair. It's like, okay, Moses, no, I'm not giving you another one. A second pair. Moses tiptoed down the mountain. I don't know if it's in the book, but that's in the movie. Tiptoed down the mountain. He didn't look at anyone to talk to anybody because he knew he'd throw him at him. He ran home to the temple. He found this golden box called the Ark of the Covenant. He lifted up the mercy seat and he put them in there and then he covered it up. And he said, okay, don't touch them. Don't touch them. Never lift that thing up. The law of God only belongs inside of mercy. If you put it in the hands of man, they will be broken and you're going to kill everybody.
Amen.
The law of God was never meant to be in the hands of men. Because we hurt people, we don't understand, we're confused. They have to be put inside love. And And when they put inside love, they are fulfilled. That is a miracle to me. The law that was absolutely impossible to keep, when you put it inside of love, everyone is kept. Unbroken. God. A miracle. There was a time during the history of Israel when the Ark of the Covenant was captured by the Philistines. I don't know if you saw the movie or read the book. But Israel's arch enemy, the Philistines, they captured the Ark. And the Philistines said, "Hooray! We got the Ark!" So they took the Ark of the Covenant and they brought it into their cities. And they brought it into their city and they had the Ark. And they were so happy they had the Ark. We got grace on top of grace. Hallelujah! We got the Ark. But it was in the wrong hands. It was in the hands of the flesh. It was in the hands of our carnal thinking and understanding. Because remember, the Lord is grace, and Christ is grace. It's grace on top of grace. Sometimes we get a hold of His grace on top of grace, and we don't know what we're going to do. And that's where we live today. That's where the confusion today. We got grace on top of grace. I can do anything I want anytime, and so can everybody else, huh? Philistines thought so. They had grace on top of grace, but it was in the wrong hands. It didn't belong in the hands of flesh and then in the thinking of flesh. You know what happened to that Philistine city? All kinds of destruction and death and swords. And the Philistines, after a while, said, "You know what? I don't want grace on top of grace." It's like, get rid of it. Get rid of it. Can you apply that today, or don't I have to break it down for you? I'll break it down a little bit. Because when we have this understanding of this freedom we have in God, that grace covers and you're forgiven, and no matter what you do in life, you're holy, righteous, and true. It's the truth. Grace covers you, but it also teaches you this. Grace doesn't give you the license to sin, as Scripture says. Can you do everything? Can you do anything you want? Yeah, sure you can. Sure you can. You can paint outside the lines all you want. But it doesn't bring harmony. It doesn't bring peace. It just brings a life that's kind of out there. Can anybody please believe? Amen. It's grace on top of grace. You know, I come here when I want, do this when I want, go over there when I want. Hey, there's no law. Well, there is. There is. There is a law. It's just covered by grace. Have you ever done that to somebody? Covered somebody with grace? Anybody? Anybody ever covered somebody with grace? Okay, I got a little participation today. Yeah, you've covered somebody with grace. And the backside of that, maybe you knew the backside was coming, you've also been covered by grace. Because grace will always cover and love will always cover, but it doesn't mean that there isn't a law. It's just covered up by love. So the Philistines, the flesh, your carnal thinking and my carnal thinking, we can't handle grace on top of grace. And it still hurts us. Amen, Robert? So then they said, give it back to the Israelites. We don't want it. And they finally got the greatest trophy of all. And they gave it back to them. Put it on a cart. And if that cart goes back to Israel, we know it's God. Sure enough, they put it on a cart. And all by itself, these oxen brought the ark back to Israel. And the Philistines were hiding in the bushes, watching the ox take the ark back to Israel. The Israelites got the Ark of the Covenant back. Hey, hey, hey. They said, what's this grace on top of grace? The believing ones, the circumcised one, what's this grace on top of grace? They said, you need to get rid of this. You need to follow that law. Grace on top of grace is killing you. You got to get rid of this. Get rid of all that love. Follow the law. Because we put grace on top of grace, and it seems like it's not working. It's not working. You say, I don't want it. I don't want it. I don't want it. It's still not working. So we get it back, and we say, okay, well, let's get rid of the love then. Just preach the law. So the first Israelite city that got the Ark of the Covenant, they said, okay, get rid of this. They looked in, and what happened? They all died. 50,070 people died. Because you cannot look right at it without mercy. It still brings death. Yes. Still brings death. Amen. So the answer isn't coloring outside the lines, and the answer isn't coloring inside the lines. What do you do? Sometimes we don't know. We just don't know. And we're so confused. The other rules, well, they're not rules, shouldn't they? But I hopefully God will give us a beautiful picture where it says, first of all, take this and put it back. Put it back. And then he says, stop touching it. He says, yeah, just put it here. He said, put it in the tabernacle. But not until I finally got to the tabernacle of David was everybody safe. Like, woo-hoo-hoo! When David finally took it to his tabernacle and it was in its final resting place, it was singing and dancing and rejoicing. When grace was in its rightful place, they rejoiced. And I know God, because of his great life and love, grace will take its course. It's going to go through the Philistine city. It's going to go through the city that takes it off. You experience every one of them. Can I get a witness from anybody? You call it outside the lines, you call it inside the lines, you're trying to figure it out, and it's still a mess. Until grace comes in its rightful place. And then it brings true life and peace to everyone it should. Amen?
Amen.
Got one more thing I want to share. So let me say this in closing. And I want to say this as a family. I want to say this to our family first. Because love covers, but love teaches. We are free from the law. Every one of you are free from the law. Every one of you. That means that you have graduated from it. You have grown up. Okay? Free from the law doesn't mean it's no good. It just means you graduated because it still exists. It's just elementary. Okay? You're all free from it. Graduated. Well done. But that means you grew up. But let me tell you what it is now. Because we are not free from love, though. Because we are free from the law, we are not free from love. I want our family to hear this. We are not free from caring about each other. We are not free from honoring each other and honoring the house and honoring the things of God. We are not free from respect. That we don't have to respect each other anymore. We are not free from loyalty and trust and truth and honor. That is not what we're free from. These are the basic elementary things that are inside your heart that causes you to be the quintessential Renaissance man, that causes you to be the Michelangelo who draws the Sistine Chapel, because you have been free from the law of sin and death, but you are not free from the love. You are not free from caring and honoring and respecting and loving each other.
Yeah, right.
All right. This is grace on top of grace. And when grace comes in its final resting place, then you will see life and fruit and abundance. What you want to see in your home, what you want to see in the schools, what you want to see in the church house, what you want to see in the And let me say, don't be afraid when the ark is in the Philistine territory, and don't be afraid when you're pulling the lid off. Don't be afraid, because eventually it will go in its final place. And you'll have a beautiful mixture of both love and truth. And it will bring peace to all men. Once you all stand, I think I have one more verse I'm going to close with. I'm going to ask praise team, yeah, God bless you all. Yeah. Yeah, that's your cue. They stay in composure. We're going to end off with a fast song, because I believe it's a time of celebration, not a time of sorrow. But sometimes we've got to learn what grace is and what grace is not. I found this passage, Isaiah chapter 16, verse 5. You can look at it later. I'm going to read it to you. It says, in regard to the tabernacle of David, it says, in love, a throne will be established. In love, truth will be established. In love. And it says, from the faithful throne, a person will sit, which is you. One who will always do what is just and right. Amen?
Amen?
This is what God is doing in our lives. This is what God is doing in the earth. And I love the fact that it brings clarity and reconciliation. And we have a marriage of the both. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Okay, today is the day, I believe. All right, hallelujah.